The following program certainly can be sickening if one listens to it with the wrong ear. And I suggest you use your correct ear, friends. Once in a great while, we have to take recognizance, if you don't mind the pompous word, the kind of word that David Susskind would use so well. Once in a while, we have to take recognizance of the totally scary in our lives. We have to deal with the evil that lurks in the hearts of all men. We have to deal also with that dark, black kind of blob that we're always scurrying away from in the alleys of our mind. What a scary sound. Let's try another one, Herb. Can you imagine that echoing throughout some alley when you walk along, say, and you got your bag of groceries, couple of cans of Campbell's pork and beans and some silver cup bread and your weekly supply of Twinkies and some Skippy chunk-style peanut butter, when suddenly out of the darkness, good God, great Scott! So tonight, we have to take recognizance of evil that is everywhere. You know, I've often thought, I don't know why I thought this, and I have thought it quite often, I don't know why, but I've often thought of the stuff that is going on right at this minute, right this instant, that goes even beyond your imagination of the evil that is around. Have you thought about, I mean, stuff that you don't even... You don't know about it. It's out there somewhere. Something is happening right now that's just fantastic. Now, I'm not talking about violence. Again, that's something else. Violence is not... It's frightening, of course, but it isn't eerie. You know what violence is. If somebody's getting mugged or somebody's blowing up somebody's house or something like that. This is all frightening enough, but it's clean cut. You know what it is. And there it is. But I'm talking about the macabre. The macabre. And I don't know whether you saw this piece, but you couldn't write. Can you imagine writing a one-act play like this? And it's being done, let's say, at this very avant-garde little theater down the Armpit Theater down at 4th Street. See, it's fantastic little avant-garde theater, Cafe La Papa or something. Can you imagine this one-act play? And this is... Of course, nobody can write anything that is as bad as what really happens. If you will, please, Herbert. Police in New Orleans arrested Effie Serenutis on charges of disturbing the peace. Her living in a squalid room with the skeleton of her mother, who apparently had died years before her. Pete Schuster, a coroner's investigator, said, and we quote, "When we got in there, she was sitting at a table eating raw biscuits. She was sitting in a daze. Her mother was in the bedroom on the floor, covered with a bedspread. There was a embroidered pillow under her skull. The house was dark and filthy. Dirty with years and years of accumulated dust."
Well,
Schuster said that Effie told him that her mother had, quote, she'd been in a coma for 3 years. Quote, my mother hasn't eaten so good for 3 years. In fact, she hasn't eaten at all, you know. That's enough. They're out there screaming and yelling and hitting each other already. What a story. Now that there it is. For 3 years, I'm sure that, you know, people walking by this house or any other house. And you know how they found it? They found it, the building inspector came around saying the house was in real bad shape, apparently. And they decided that they had to take a look at it. And this woman wouldn't let him in for weeks, and finally they had to get in, and so they did. It says, we found an open fire going in a white enamel pot on the floor. All utilities had been off for 3 years. There was no water. What a scene. That's right out of Shirley Jackson. Well, I don't know whether it's out of Shirley Jackson so much, does she? In a way, yes, except that no, not exactly, but it's more out of life than it is out of Shirley Jackson. But you know, every time I run into a story like that, I think of the stuff that's going on out there that you can't imagine, and yet is going on not too far from where you are. It's just, you know, it's really happening. Let me tell you a little story. You want to hear a story one time that I ran into one time? I'll never believe this. I don't think, I still to this day, you know, some things happen to you so strange, at least it's happened to me, that they're so far out of the realm of your life that you don't even talk about them. It's just like some crazy moment out of a movie. Well, I'll tell you something I don't think I've ever told you. You've probably never heard this story. So you listen very carefully to this one. It's a strange moment. I was at a party one time. This is just when I first got to New York. And I was very innocent about New York. I didn't know much about New York at all, except, you know, I was all excited about being here. And, you know, the city, when you first arrive in New York, know the feeling of coming to New York, you're going to be involved in a career, at least you hope you are, and all this. You just, the city just engulfs you. It's a fantastic feeling of, on one hand, a feeling of being lost in a vast whirlpool. On the other hand, there's a feeling of great euphoria. You're constantly, because you just go and go, and all sides of you see this tremendous activity. It sort of draws you in. And it's like no other city that I know of, and I've lived in other cities and worked in other cities, but New York really is unique in that respect. It's an experience. It's a total experience. That's why nobody will ever be able to put down on paper what it's like to live in New York, because of the extremely subjective things that happen to you in New York. It can only happen in New York. And so you tend to live a private public life in this city. But anyway, I was at a party, see, and I arrived. Before I do that, I better get the commercials out of the way there so we don't have any confusion here.
Tijuana Smalls. It's,
you know, that story. Yeah, I must say that this story of the skeleton in the closet reminded me of something that happened to me one time. Not nearly as evil, but it could have been. And it was two things that happened to me like this. They both happened just about the same time, and they forever gave me this feeling of insecurity, but this feeling that there really is more out there than meets the eye. That no matter where you look, if you look at a block of buildings, if you stand back, you see, you're standing back, let's say, on the corner of, let's just take, for example, 40, 8th and 1st Avenue or something. Let's take 53rd and 2nd, something like that. Just, you know, just a neighborhood. And you see all these buildings. You just take a look at one. Just stand there for a minute. Just look at those buildings. Just look at them. And your eye encompasses a great wide scope of buildings. You see a lot of concrete, a lot of bricks. You see a lot of windows, maybe even a little sky. A lot of cars going around. But here you see these buildings. Well, I'll guarantee you that as your eye looks at this fan, this panorama of buildings, that your eye is encompassing at least one or two or three apartments where the situation, the scene that's going on there, goes beyond anything you have ever seen in a movie. I'll guarantee you this. You couldn't imagine it until you run into it. I'll give you three of them that I've run into here in New York. I'm at a party, see? And I was, you know, standing around with a martini, and I have no remembrance of how or why or who invited me to this party. I couldn't even tell you really where it was. You know, you go to so many parties when you first come to New York that you can't even remember the places. All I know, it was someplace over on the east side in the middle 30s, roughly. This is the only thing I can remember about it. But that actually isn't very important to the story. And anyway, it was a good party. It was not a, you know, wasn't any kind of a swinging scene. It was just a party. Somebody said, let's go to this party. Now, to begin with, I'll tell you how, yes, I do remember how I got invited to this party. I ran into, this is what you run into constantly in New York. One day I'm walking down the street of New York. I wasn't here more than a month. I'm walking along and I see this familiar figure up ahead. At least he hit me. It was like I recognized him. I somehow remembered him. And he was familiar. There's this figure, staggering drunk, absolutely fantastically drunk, staggering around. And I see this character up ahead of me just bumping off the buildings, running into the fire plugs and all that kind of stuff, people avoiding him. Well, I often wonder what happened to him. And I'm walking along. See, I think, gee, that guy looks vaguely familiar. I can't figure out who it is. And I catch up to him, and I walk past him, and he's staggering around. And I sort of just, you know, look at a guy that's drunk. You don't want to make a big issue of it. So I walk past him, and all of a sudden he hollers out to me, "Oh, gee, how are you?" So I couldn't get around it. I did know him, and I turned around, and I could not believe my eyes. I couldn't believe who it was. It was a guy that I had known about a year before when I was going to, in fact, I was going to school. And I knew this guy about a year prior to this meeting. And you'll never guess what he had been. He was a leading Franciscan monk. And the last time I had seen him, it was in connection with some kind of a program I was involved in where they had these monks come in and do, there was something very involved with theology and so forth. I don't recall. I was assigned to this thing. And here he was, and I had seen him on a couple of occasions and in the week. While we were doing this show, and he was all, you know, dressed in the monk's habit and so forth. And now, here he is in New York, and he is unbelievable. He is staggered around, and he is just... So I said, what do you call him, you know? You can't walk him and say, "Hello, Friar Tuck," and he's falling up and down, hitting his head on the... And so I said, "Hello, how are you?" And he said, "Oh, yeah." He said, "How about coming? Let's have a drink." So I said, "Well, gee, all right, I'd be a little flown." So we went into this place, and I got the story out of him. And it turns out he had one day he just that was the ball game. He walked out of the monastery one day when they were doing something. They were supposed to be doing something, and he just took off, and he's been drinking and doing it all ever since. I mean, totally. He was completely fallen in the theological sense. So anyway, we wound up. He invited me to a party. So I was all by myself in New York. I was a little lonely, as you always would be in the city. So I said, all right, I'd come. So anyway, I did come to the party, and it was quite an elegant party, and a lot of nice people standing around. And here he is now. Now he's all cleaned up now. He's just starting on this day's drunk. He'd become a fantastic alcoholic, by the way. And he is just starting on this drunk for this day, because later that night he was thrown out, breaking a window. But, he was something else again. I wonder whatever happened to this guy. But nevertheless, I'm standing around the party, and I got talking to people, and I meet this very elegant girl. Really an elegant girl. She looked a lot like, a little bit like Susanna York, actually. A very beautiful, elegant girl. And I remember now, it's all coming back. This is how intelligent she was. She was a language major from one of the West Coast schools, and she was now working as a guide and a translator at the United Nations. Very elegant, you see. So I said, gee, I'd like to visit the UN. I'd never visited the UN at that point. She says, well, come on over sometime and give me a call at this number at the United Nations, and I'll arrange it. So we were very elegant. It's very circumspect, see, very elegant. So we're having a drink, and I'm wearing my best suit, and it's a real New York party, and it's in the Murray Hill district, and the apartment was very chic and elegant, had paintings and all this. So I'm absolutely my best behavior. I'm trying to curb my Indiana accent. So we're drinking the martinis, and so I said, well, I'd be glad to. I'm going to give you a call. Now, remember, I'm going to do this. Because, you know, I was aware that, well, there's a lot of talk goes on at cocktail parties. It doesn't really mean anything, see. So I said, now, you really are serious. I'd like to really see the UN. So she said, yes, of course I'm serious. So a couple of days later, after the party, I go into a phone booth, and I call the number. And it was the United Nations, and I get her on the phone. And I said, this is Jean Shepherd, I met you at this party. She says, oh, yes, of course. She said, gee, I'm glad you called. And I said, well, I'd like to see the UN. She says, well, can you come on over this afternoon? I've got some free time. I'd love to show you around. So I said, sure, groovy. So I rushed off and get in the bus on 42nd. I go east. Well, I get over to the UN, and there she is in this uniform. Boy, she looked great. You know, she looked like you've seen them, you know, over there. She's really something else. So we go all over this building, and she's showing me the UN, and she knows everybody. She's got this beautiful accent. She speaks French and German and Greek and very something else. And so I was really impressed. So I thought to myself, well, gee, maybe I ought to take this girl out for dinner or something. I didn't know anybody in town, so she showed me around. I felt a little, I'd like to see her again. So I said to her, I said, how about going out to dinner some night? She says, that'd be great. That's wonderful. And I said, sure. And so we made arrangements. And we met a couple of nights later, and we met. And, of course, I was very broke. I had hardly any money. We met in this elegant East Side restaurant. We had a meal, and it was very nice. And so I said, well, gee, it's been nice seeing you, and I'd like to see you again. She says, well, fine. And so I put her in a cab. I said, I'll take you home. She says, no. She says, I've got to get up early in the morning, so I'll take a cab, and I'll see you then, and give me a call when you'd like to fight again. So with that, she took off, this elegant girl, beautiful, beautiful suit and everything. Well, a couple of days later, I talked to her again, and we went out to dinner again. This time, a strange thing happened. We're sitting at the table, and we ordered a bottle of wine. And I'm thinking in my mind, oh, boy, this is going to break me for the next month, but you know what the hell. I mean, you know, I was kind of down and low. I was out of work, so I said, fine, let's get some wine. So I ordered this Chablis, and we sat there, and we're drinking the wine. I had a glass of wine. It was in a French restaurant over in the 50s. And so she wound up drinking the whole bottle of wine, which is all right. You know, I thought, great. You know, she's enjoying it. So she drank the whole bottle of wine. And remember, there's nothing, no ulterior thing going on here. Just somebody I wanted to talk to, that's all. And she knew New York. It was kind of great talk to somebody. So we get out on the street, and she's begged a little bit. You see, and she's really getting a little bit. She's crying and stuff, you know, that kind of thing. I couldn't quite figure out what I'm supposed to do now. She's kind of weeping about something, and I said, well, gee, let's call her Mabel. That wasn't her name. I said, well, gee, Mabel, I had such a great time tonight. I'm sorry you're feeling this way. But obviously she was a crying drunk is what it was. She was drunk. She was one of the types that cry when she drinks. See? I was talking about her mother and so on. This beautiful girl. And I says, well, all right. Look, Mabel, if you're feeling this bad, let me take you home. She says, all right, all right. So we get in this cab. Now I'm going to take her home. See, and I wanted to get rid of her at this point because she was crying. It was kind of a messy situation. And so I said, where do you live? We're in the cab. There's a long, pregnant pause, and she says, well, all right. And she told me this address. It was up in the 80s, on the east side, over near First Avenue. So we get in the cab. You know, we're in the cab now, so we go on up this place up there, and the cab driver turns into this dark street over on the east side, over there by the river. He says, it's very dark. And, he says, hey, where's that number? And she says, oh, I'll get out here. So I thought, well, what the hell? Here's this blackness, nothing around us but blackness, and there's a vacant lot there and a lot of weeds and an old abandoned car and stuff like that. She says, I'll get out here. So I wasn't going to let her get out there, and she's a little drunk, so I got out of the car, and I said, okay, this is it. So here we are in this strange place, and I said, well, where do you live? And she says, you go home. She says, go on, I don't want you here. I said, wait a minute here. This is a very strange-looking place, you see. I'm a little worried now she's drunk. Well, to boil it down, she says, I live over there. And she points at a building. I couldn't believe it. It was a building that was one-third demolished. They were demolishing. Here's this building. I said, you live over there? And she says, yes, I live over there. And I said, well, let's go. I'll take you over there. Because I was afraid of something happening to her. She was drunk. She was a beautiful girl. So we go picking our way over this rubble, this vacant lot. We find ourselves in back of this building now. It's an ancient building, terrible old place. It's abandoned. It's an old abandoned building with the doors hanging off, the windows out. You've seen those buildings before? It's been empty for 2 years. I couldn't believe it. We go down in the basement, and we start going up this rickety flight of stairs. We arrive at the top of this building, and it's completely black, cold, no lights. It is an abandoned building. I'm wondering, what the... It's some kind of an insane dream here. I can't believe it. I can't believe what I'm seeing. We turn into a room with all the wallpaper hanging off of it. And there are old broken pieces of glass all over the floor. And in the corner is a pile of burlap and an old comforter. And on the corner of the wall, hanging from the wall, was what looked like an orange crate that had been hammered up and was now hanging from this place. And in it, there were little things like a mirror. There was a box of powder, and I could see a piece of paper laying on the floor with some clothes piled on it. And I couldn't believe what I saw. In the pile of rubble was what looked like a 3-year-old girl asleep. I couldn't believe it. It's dark. The light is shining in through the window. And I said, do you have any light? And she said, yeah, she's looking for matches. So I said, here, I've got a lighter. And I lit the lighter, and there was a candle there on top of this orange crate. I lit the candle. And here was this little girl asleep, all covered up with burlap sacks. I thought she was dead at first. She was asleep. And she started to wake up. And I said, you know, what is this? She said, this is my little girl. She's drunk. I said, this is your little girl? She says, yes. I said, well, you live here? She says, yes, this is where I live. I said, well, where's your husband? I didn't know she had a husband. She says, oh, he hitchhiked to California. He's gone. I says, he's gone. what about your mother and your family? I was really scared. She said, you know what I think you better do? And I said, no. She says, I think you better leave before I call the police. I said, okay. The little girl was now crawling around in the sacks, and her mother was combing her hair in the light of the candle. And I went down the stairs with the wind blowing through the hallway. I could hear glass crunching underfoot. I got down in the basement, and I could smell the gas drifting in from that great excavation. I walked out into the alley and picked my way through the barrels and out finally out of the street where I caught a cab. I haven't thought much about it since. Just another New York date. Now, that is not an invented story. That's a true, absolutely factual story. I don't know whatever happened to the girl. Never called her, never saw her again. Obviously, she didn't want anybody messing with her life. And I wasn't about to have the police called. Okay. You made your bed, baby, you lie in it. That's the end of it. Now, incidentally, I went past that building later several times, and it was and is, been gone ever since, but it was a building that was an abandoned building that they were just simply blasting out and chopping down, you know, like there's many old tenements over in that area. This beautiful girl. Do you want to hear another story? All right. I shouldn't tell you these stories. Well, I'll tell you a story. This one here is even, in some ways, even more eerie. It's so eerie. Well, all right, I'll tell you this story. I'll tell you another one. This is Tales of New York, you know. This friend of mine, a very straight type friend, just a friend that I knew from the business, was looking for an apartment. And you know how it is when you look for an apartment in New York, you know, there's all kinds. Oh, yeah, it's a real drag. And he was taking the Times every Sunday and cutting out all kinds of ads in the Village Voice and the Villager, every place where they would list apartments, saying, trying to get this apartment. What he was a small, two-room apartment just for one person, but it was in a fairly good neighborhood. He wasn't looking for any loft or anything like that or, you know, some dive. He wanted a nice little apartment. They're not too easy to find, you know. You can find big apartments fairly easily if you're ready to pop for it. And you can find little apartments in bad neighborhoods. But you can't find that in-between apartment, you see. And this is what was hanging him up. So he's looking and looking and looking and looking. Well, finally, one day, it was a fantastic moment. He said to me, we were sitting around, and he says, listen, he said, I'm going over into the East 50s. He said, I got a lead on an apartment. I said, yeah. And I said, what do you mean? He says, well, I got a call from this agent. He'd been registered with a lot of apartment agents, saying real estate guys and that. He said, I got a call from this agent. And the agent said that this is an apartment that X had and has just left. Well, X was a famous celebrity. And so I said, well, gee, you know, that sounds interesting. He said, well, I don't know. They were very strange about it. He said, I don't know quite what the story is. He said, but the guy told me that the apartment, that they could give it to me fairly cheap because the apartment needs work. And X had this apartment. And so I said, well, gee, that sounds strange. I can't figure out why X would have an apartment that needs a lot of work. X was a very famous celebrity, incidentally. So he said, well, I don't know what it's all about. He says that they told me to come on over this afternoon if I want to come to this apartment and see it. And if I decide to take it, he says, they will knock off X amount on the rent for the next year if I will do the work involved in it, if I'll see that the work gets done. So I said, well, gee, that sounds fascinating. All right. He said, you want to go over? And I said, sure. Not realizing what I was about to get into, you know. I just going up to an apartment. I had a couple hours. So I said, yeah. So we went over to the east side. We took the cab. And here's this elegant apartment house, a real nice apartment house. And it's over on the east side near 2nd Avenue. in the 50s, in case you're interested. And this is the high rent district in New York. And so we walked down to the, and here's a doorman out in front. Of course, it's a really good apartment. And immediately my friend says, gee, I can't understand why I'm getting this apartment so cheap, you know, this building like this. And we found out. So I walked into the lobby with him, and the doorman is a very elegant doorman. And the guy says to the doorman, he said, we're here to see, I'll just invent a number. This is not the actual number. We're here to see 12D. And he says, oh, all right, fine. And a funny look on his face, just a strange look. All right, sir. He said, I'd better go up with you. He says, here's the key for 12D. He says, I'm supposed to be the representative here on the floor, so I'll take you up. And he said, I'll wait for you in the elevator. So I said, okay. So on the way up in the elevator, this guy is looking kind of strange. This is the doorman, saying he's operating the elevator because apparently the elevator guy was off for 10 minutes getting a coffee or something. So we're on our way up in this elegant apartment house. Very elegant, the teak wood elevator with all carved things on the side of, gee whiz, you know. And so we're going up to 12D. We get up to 12D, and the guy says, well, listen, he said, before we get out, he said, look, he said, I want to ask you a favor before you look at the apartment. My friend turns and says, what? What do you mean? What favor? He says, well, would you please not tell anybody about this if you decide not to take it? And so he said, well, all right, what is it? Has something to do with the rent? Or maybe you don't want to rent it to everybody? No, no, he says, not that at all. He says, you'll understand if you look at it. And so my friend says, sure, he doesn't, nothing ventured, nothing gained, so who cares, he's not going to tell me. He says, fine, I won't tell anybody. So he hands him the key. With that, he says to me, he says, sir, would you mind not going back with him unless you want to rent the apartment too? I said, well, okay. I said, what the hell's going on here? By this time, it's a strange atmosphere. And here is this hall. It was really a lovely hall, with a thick carpet, and you saw these beautiful apartment doors. This is really Sheiksville all the way. So my friend says, look, friend, he says to the elevator operator, I don't know what's going on here, but if I go back to look at that apartment, he's going back with me because, and then he came up with a story. He says, he's my lawyer, and we're going to decide whether or not we should fix this thing. So with that, the elevator, I thought you were just a friend. He says, oh, no, of course, if you represent the gentleman here, naturally, you can go back and see, but I hope that you won't spread the story around. So I said, of course not. We have our legal ethics. And so we went walking back in this hall, and my buddy says, what the hell is this? I said, I don't know. And so we walk halfway back, and now 12D, again, this is a fictitious number, 12D was one of the best located apartments on the floor. It was a beautiful location, right on the corner. Obviously, he's going to get a lot of light and windows and so forth in there. He sticks the key into the door. And he turns it and pulls the door back. Friends, never will I forget the sight. Or the total sensory event that occurred. He opened the door, and out of the door came this fantastic aroma. It's incredible. It just sort of drifted out. It was like, well, how can I explain it? It was almost like if you took the New York City dump, multiplied it by 5,000, talking about the aroma, and then compressed it, and then released it all at once. Turns to his left, and he's feeling for the switch on the door. You know, he's feeling in the wall. And he's feeling, he says, what the hell's going on here? And he flicks his hand, and about 10 giant cockroaches fly off his hand. He flicks the door, the light on, and wow! Fantastic apartment. Piled to the ceiling. Wall to wall. Was the most unimaginable pile of garbage, junk, crud, corruption right to the ceiling. Blackness, whiskey bottles, moldy TV dinners 4 years old, old hamburgers, cheeseburgers, triple thing that you could imagine. And it was kind of like going through a tunnel. You walk through this tunnel, this place was just unbelievable. You could smell this aroma coming out. And it was a two-room apartment with a bath. The next room was almost unapproachable. It was just so packed, high with stuff. We fought our way back through the bathroom, to the bathroom. I can't describe the filth in the bathroom. Indescribable. There were every conceivable thing back. And in the bathtub had been laid a mattress. This person apparently slept in the mattress, or on this mattress, in the bathtub. And that was it. That was the apartment. Fantastic mess. I mean, it was so, I can't describe it to you. You'd have to see this thing. The smell and the aroma and the bottles and the moldy food, bags of all kinds and descriptions. Torn pieces of clothing. Shoes here and there. We stood in the bathroom. The mirror was busted out. The mirror over the sink was just broken to bits. And there were pieces of mirror all over the floor, which might have said something about the psychological problems of the person who had rented this apartment for 4 years. We stood in the bath. And he says, would you believe this? I said, Bob, I've seen a lot of stuff in my time. I ain't never seen nothing like this. We turn around, we walk out, and close the door. We walk down the aisle. All these nice people coming out to go to dinner ahead of us. These elegant East 50s swinging types. We got into the teakwood elevator. Now the elevator man is out the lead. And I felt as though the smell from this apartment was surrounding us like some aroma. Felt evil, unclean. We got downstairs. The doorman was there and he said, shall I tell them that you're taking the apartment, sir? That's it. I don't have the next 4 years to work out. He said, did X-Ready have that apartment? And the doorman said, that's right. He's out in Hollywood now making a picture. And he wired us that he wasn't coming back. He was giving up the apartment. And he went in and opened it up. We couldn't believe what we saw. But please don't say anything about it. It might give the building a bad name. Of men. If I told you the name of this famous Hollywood star, there's not one of you would believe it. So all you got to do is walk out on the street scene, take one look at a representative block of buildings, and your eye has encompassed at least one tiny hotbed of evil, the likes of which you could not conceivably imagine. Sleep well, gang. And by the way, it wouldn't surprise me at all if somebody is listening to this right now on a radio, in a place, in a situation, I don't want to go any further.